Our next guest is Zachary Davis. He is a senior associate who specializes in Indigenous law, and today he's giving a presentation called Métis Scrip, A Claim Against the Crown. He joins us this morning to talk a little bit about that discussion and why it's so important. Thanks so much for coming in.
Of course, of course.
So first of all, you got your talk today, but to clarify for people, what is Métis Scrip in the first place, and why is this so important to be talking about now?
It's a great question, and it's a great question because I think it's one that way more people need to know the answer to.
Mm-hmm.
The basic story goes like this. When Canada, the new country, acquired the land that became the Prairie Provinces mm-hmm. from the Hudson's Bay Company, it did it with a promise that was worked into the Canadian Constitution that it would deal with the claims of the Indigenous people in the territory.
Mm-hmm.
There were two people at the time, and it was acknowledged at the time. There were the First Nations and the Métis. The First Nations got treaties. The Métis got scrip. Scrip was very different. Scrip was an individual entitlement, a coupon, that could, in theory, be redeemed for land. The issue is that it was extremely convoluted and difficult to exchange the coupon for land. And in a lot of cases, the land that could be acquired wasn't anywhere near where the Métis people were or wanted to live.
Right.
So, and I don't want to exaggerate the numbers, but where studies have been done, between 90 and 98% of these coupons end up in the hands of white land speculators.
Hmm.
The Métis don't get the land, they're dispossessed. This creates two major problems. First of all is the dispossession. The
sure.
Métis have nowhere to live, and they end up squatting on Crown land, living on road allowances, and they get the nickname the road allowance people.
Right.
The other problem is for the speculators, because there was a legal requirement built into a lot of this scrip that in order to redeem it, the person to whom it was issued had to present themselves at the land office.
Okay.
And that person was long gone.
Sure.
So what they did was they engaged in fraudulent impersonation. And they impersonated the Métis person to redeem the coupon. This was so well known at the time that it was kind of common knowledge among the government, the speculators, and of course the Métis.
Mm-hmm.
The Métis bring a case in order to seek some justice against Richard Secord, who was an Edmontonian who profited greatly from land scrip. And this ruffled a lot of feathers. So James Lougheed, who's Peter Lougheed's grandfather.
Sure.
Was a senator at the time,
uh-huh.
and he pushed through an amendment to the criminal code that made it impossible to prosecute Métis scrip, effectively protecting the speculators and
wow.
the white interests and making sure that the Métis got nothing.
Wow. So here we are all this time later, and this is still needs to be explained and untangled. How do you even approach this, and what's being done now to address this?
Another good question. For almost 100 years, nothing was being done. The government's position was that scrip extinguished any Métis rights, and that was the end of the story.
Mm-hmm.
There was a similar but not identical pattern of fraud and speculation that happened in Manitoba.
Right.
And in 2013, they won a case at the Supreme Court of Canada that said that the way Métis lands had been dealt with there was unconstitutional and breached the honor of the Crown, and they're now in negotiations.
Okay.
So there are two options. The Métis in Alberta could go to court, or they could negotiate. And in November of 2017, they did sign a framework agreement with the federal government to set up the basis for those negotiations. So that's just getting off the ground now.
Okay. And what's your role in all this, beyond, you know, having your talk today at the conference today? What's your role beyond that?
Right. So one of the big things I do is education, doing mm-hmm. things like this, because until people know the story, there's not going to be the public appetite for reconciliation.
Absolutely, yeah.
More technically, though, I'm legal counsel for the Métis Nation of Alberta, and I assist them in those negotiations.
Okay. How big is this for you to explain that? How big is the public perception in gaining momentum? Explaining this to people who either didn't know that this was happening or didn't pay attention to this happening. How big is that for you?
It's huge. It's huge. And there's a long way to go. Just explaining who the Métis people are,
mm-hmm.
not as sort of a mixed race group, but as a nation that was, at the time that this happened, understood to be a distinct Indigenous people, is not something that's taught very well in our schools.
Right.
The story of the Métis in our schools really ends with Louis Riel, but that's where the scrip story begins.
Right.
And so we need to, you know, continue the narrative and make sure that this public perception takes root.
It's a whole new chapter of so many people that certainly needs to be acknowledged and recognized. Thanks so much for coming in. I know this is just scratching the surface of what you're going to be talking about. And it's something that if you're interested in, and you should be, you can learn certainly a lot more. There's a conference running today until 9 o'clock until 4 at the U of A. You will be speaking at 11.
That's right.
11 o'clock, you will be speaking a half-hour discussion. For more information, you can visit that website. You can head down to Lister Conference Center today at the U of A. It's important stuff to talk about. I really appreciate you coming in.
Of course. Thank you so much.